You may proceed.
Thank you. Well, I call to order the May 2021 meeting of the Board of Regents. Good morning to one and all. And thanks to all of you who are joining via the live stream video. We will jump right into our agenda. And our very first item of business is recognition of our outgoing Vice President for Research, Dr. Chris Kramer. And I'll turn it over to you, President Gable, for your comments and remarks.
Thank you, Chair Powell. Good morning, everybody. So I have the pleasure of speaking on behalf of the university to express our profound gratitude to Chris Kramer for his service as the Vice President of Research, as is customary for someone who departs the university in a vice presidential role. But what many people may not know is that Chris has been at the university for 29 years and has only been the Vice President of Research for the last few of those years. And his contributions have been cumulative and stacked over the course of nearly 30 years of undeniably impactful service as a university citizen. During his tenure at the university, he was a faculty member and in several leadership positions prior to becoming the Vice President for Research. As the VPR, Chris brought the university's research enterprise to a new level of success by building on notable historical strengths and standing on others' shoulders, but also with his tremendous appetite for the right kind of risks, exploring new and innovative opportunities, all of which are sustainable now, thanks to his vision. He is everyone's good friend, while also being true to his values and his strengths and his opinions, enthusiastically, collaboratively, with a great sense of humor, and as I said before, with just the right risk appetite. He's a wonderful scientist and a wonderful leader, but most importantly, he's a wonderful person, and we're going to miss him tremendously. So Chris, thank you on my behalf and on behalf of the whole university for your service, and we wish you the very best. And now I will turn it back to you, Chair Powell.
Thank you, President Gable. And so I have the honor of virtually presenting Chris Kramer with a certificate. And here it is, Chris, virtually the certificate. And it reads as follows. The Regents of the University of Minnesota recognize with sincere gratitude and appreciation the exceptional dedication, service, and contributions of Christopher J. Kramer, Vice President for Research. As Vice President, Kramer led innovation and success in the university's research enterprise. Under his leadership, the university exceeded $1 billion in annual research expenditures for the first time in its history and secured $87.5 million in funding commitments from the U.S. Department of Defense to make the University of Minnesota a home site to BioMADE. Kramer also spearheaded the university's growth in technology commercialization efforts, culminating in the university's Venture Center launching a record 38 startup companies based on discoveries and inventions by University of Minnesota researchers. Kramer has served the university for 29 years, first joining in 1992 as a faculty member in the Department of Chemistry. During his tenure, he held several leadership positions in the College of Science and Engineering, including Associate Dean for Academic Affairs and Associate Dean for Research and Planning. His significant impact on the University of Minnesota will be felt for decades to come. On behalf of the university community, the Regents extend their respect and deepest gratitude to Christopher J. Kramer for his outstanding service to the University of Minnesota, and we wish him well in his future endeavors. And it's dated today, May 2021. So thank you so very, very much. We really, really are so grateful for everything that you've done for us. And you've had such a great run here. And I hope that you'll have a few words for us now.
Thank you, Chair Powell. A poem by Joyce Sutphen, poet laureate of the state of Minnesota and an alumna of our renowned College of Liberal Arts. Things you didn't put on your resume. How often you got up in the middle of the night when one of your children had a bad dream. And sometimes you woke because you thought you heard a cry, but they were all sleeping. So you stood in the moonlight, just listening to their breathing. And you didn't mention that you were an expert at putting toothpaste on tiny toothbrushes and bending down to wiggle the toothbrush 10 times on each tooth while you sang the words to songs from Annie, And who would suspect that you know the fingerings to the songs in the first four books of the Suzuki violin method, and that you can do the voices of Pooh and Piglet especially well, though your absolute favorite thing to read out loud is Bedtime for Francis, and that you picked up your way of reading it from Glynis Johns, and it is, now that you think of it, rather impressive that you read all of Narnia and all of the Ring trilogy and others too many to mention here to them before they went to bed and on the way out to Yellowstone, which is another thing you don't put on the resume, how you took them to the ocean and the mountains and brought them safely home. I love that poem. And I love that universities like ours help to shape poets. Of course, being a professor or being a senior administrator is not really the same thing as being a parent, but I submit that the Venn diagrams of their respective responsibilities or their respective rewards have large areas of overlap. In all three, one does best when one is informed by empathy and by compassion. I've been blessed with an amazing 29 years at the University of Minnesota. To the extent that I've enjoyed some success, I owe thanks to far more individuals than I can name in this brief moment before the board. So I'll be addressing that obligation in other venues. Here, I want to close by thanking only one person. President Joan T.A. Gable, from the moment you were chosen to lead this institution, I've been humbled by your confidence in me and my superb team. I've learned from your decisive leadership, and I've watched as you brought to bear the empathy and compassion that I mentioned earlier to bring us safely home through a pandemic and a host of other challenges, many, alas, still ongoing. Being a university president is a thankless job in 2021. One is held responsible for solving intractable societal ills, generations in the making, or the consequences of public health emergencies striking as a bolt from the blue, and one is subject to the most abhorrent personal attacks from all sides when attempting to make principled progress. It's a literal shame. So I want to take this opportunity to offer my personal thanks to you for your mentorship, for your dedication to our institution, and for your inspirational ability to bring humor and good cheer to your leadership day after day. The university's lucky to have you. I've been lucky to work with you. Chair Powell, members of the board, it's been a privilege to serve. Thank you for affording me this time to reflect, and may you help guide the University of Minnesota to remain strong in its dedication to the proposition that we are all ennobled by understanding and the search for truth. VPR out.
Thank you, Chris, for those wonderful words. We all are going to want a copy of that poem. And I know I speak for all of us for your guidance around empathy and all of our highest values as we continue to go forward. So thank you. Thank you for your service and your words. And we really do wish you the very best. And hopefully there'll be a way that we can stay in touch with you from time to time. And so very, very best. Okay. We'll move now to our next item of business, which is approval of minutes. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
And a second.
Second.
So moved and seconded. We'll, if there are any comments or discussion, please use raise hand. And I don't see any raised hands. So Mr. Steves, if you'll call the roll, please.
On approval of the minutes, Regent Davenport.
Yes.
Regent Davenport votes yes. Regent Farnsworth.
Yes.
Regent Farnsworth votes yes. Regent Hipsch.
Yes.
Regent Hipsch votes yes. Regent Johnson.
Yes.
Regent Johnson votes yes. Regent Kenyanya.
Yes.
Regent Kenyanya votes yes. Regent Mayron.
Yes.
Regent Mayron votes yes. Regent McMillan. Regent McMillan. Regent Rocha.
Yes.
Regent Rocha votes yes. Regent Swigum.
Yes.
Regent Swigum votes yes. Regent Verhalen.
Yes.
Regent Verhalen votes yes. Chair Powell.
Yes.
Chair Powell votes yes. Mr. Chair, there are 10 in favor and one that I believe we're having technical difficulties reaching.
Okay, by a vote of, with 10 votes in favor, the minutes are approved. So we'll now move to the report of the President, President Gable, over to you.
Thank you, Chair Powell, Vice Chair Swigum, members of the board. I want to recognize our graduates and express my sincere appreciation to them and the faculty and staff for making them the class of 2021. When we started this academic year, the end of the spring semester seemed very, very far away. And yet, what seems like the blink of the eye, we got through this past academic year that felt like both 5 minutes and an eternity. I'm sure we can all relate to that sentiment. I know I speak for all of us when I say how proud we are of all of our students, and in particular, our graduates, their professors, their advisors, their family and friends, everyone who got them over the finish line. We wish you the best. We know you are resilient and strong, and we look forward to hearing about the amazing things they will do. I also want to add my congrats in advance to our award winners. Chair Powell, I believe you will be speaking to them in more detail, but I want to make sure while I have the floor that I acknowledge their accomplishments that you will be speaking to momentarily. So with regard to updates, members of the board, I will start with MSAFE, our effort and work around campus safety. That includes the next steps with Dr. Cedric Alexander's report on policing that was presented to you in February. As a reminder, at the special meeting on April 28th, I updated you on our work to stand up the MSAFE implementation team, which is co-led by co-chairs Dr. Kathy Quick, who's an associate professor at the Humphrey School, and Dr. Mylene Colbraith, who's the director of diversity and inclusion for the Graduate School Diversity Office. This process is the process that was recommended in the external review conducted by Dr. Alexander. There are numerous items and recommendations in Dr. Alexander's report, some of which we have begun implementation on, as we've reported previously. We have been in conversations with both neighboring mayors. We have started the process, including the public forum for body cams, and we have started other reviews within the report, including the acquisition of the Rave app, which is a virtual escort that should improve safety, and other safety steps in the neighborhoods, which, while outside our policing jurisdiction, are highly populated by our students and therefore an area in which we take and have great care and concern. We've also begun the process to hire a social worker within UMPD. Our officers receive extensive training on mental health and de-escalation, far above what they're required to do. But as was identified by many of those engaged in the call for action and in Dr. Alexander's report, there's still more to do to address the types of calls and needs of the community which our police department serves. And so we think the addition of the social worker will be very helpful. Since our last report, I've also met with university governance leadership, the FCC, the System Council, to share that we are accelerating certain aspects of Dr. Alexander's recommendations because of events in recent weeks, including events in Brooklyn Center. So first, we're starting with our review around mutual aid and multi-agency response. Dr. Alexander speaks to this in his report, but it is one of many items in his report, but recent circumstances have suggested we should bring that to the fore faster than perhaps some of the other attributes of the report. We're doing some deep work on training. This is in the report, but at the request and suggestion of Chief Clark and Senior Vice President Franz, who recognize that a forward-thinking approach to how our police department is trained may address and intersect in a very robust way with many of the other recommendations and activities suggested in the report. Senior Vice President Franz and Chief Clark have met with the MSAFE co-chairs multiple times in lengthy meetings to really map how we will take the next steps. And we're finishing the process of now heading into shared governance in consultation with students, faculty, staff, and other partners and stakeholders. We will give regular updates on this work. The output of the committee may not sync up directly with board meetings. And so where appropriate, we will include the updates in agendaed reports or president's reports, depending on the robustness of the progress, or in memos and in writing in between meetings if there's news to share. And as we take these next steps, I wanna thank, there are a lot of people involved in this now who are volunteering to share their advocacy voice and expertise, particularly our MSAFE co-chairs, Dr. Quick and Dr. Colbraith. But I wanna thank everybody for engaging through the shared governance process and participating in the consultation that helps us make these really critical and important decisions together. So with regard to the pandemic and the news there, I wrote my remarks for you today before we heard from the government announcements, including CDC announcements on masking. So we will be working in parallel with the work of the board today in a sidecar with the Emergency Management Committee and other decision makers virtually to prepare, interrupt our regularly scheduled programming during the course of the day today to just give you an update on where that work goes since it's happening in real time as we work through our previously scheduled agenda. But other news related to the pandemic, we are closer to the light at the end of the tunnel without question, which is good news. And in June, you'll hear in Mission Fulfillment about fall enrollment, but I wanted to give a teaser, a trailer, if you will, about where things are going, because May 1st was the confirmation deadline. Over the summer, we will have what we call MELT, which is the students who've indicated that they are coming, but may not actually matriculate in the fall. And for those of you who are new to the board, the MELT is something that we gain expertise on predicting by virtue of historical behavior and then making projections into the future accordingly. And all of that historical behavior has been thrown out the window as we've navigated through the pandemic. So we are planning and analyzing around MELT related to last summer, and then also historical MELT and making sort of parallel projections because there's still a lot of uncertainty. So we're very aggressively admitting students this year as we did last year. So as of May 1st, Twin Cities confirmations are 16% ahead of last year and 11% ahead of fall 2019. If MELT rates are similar to what we saw in fall 2019, which was pre-pandemic, our final enrollment in the Twin Cities would be approximately 6,900 students. If MELT rates are similar to what we saw last year during the pandemic, final enrollment would be around 6,500 students. These compare to our goal of 6,100 students. So we're in very good shape. We have been working very hard on marketing. Our admissions departments are stars, unsung heroes. There's also been very thoughtful system enrollment management and system enrollment marketing. And we're tracking the international student situation very closely. That is still very challenging for many of our students who would be immigrating to the United States in order to study. As of mid-April, the entire Twin Cities wait list has been released to the system campuses, and I'm pleased to report that confirmations are up 13% system-wide. We're also seeing what a lot of people are calling the Fauci effect nationally, but locally we call the Osterholm effect, which is the uptick in health professional schools. In public health, where applications were up 30% last year, and again this year, same with medical school and nursing and other areas of allied health. We are very optimistic, particularly with the news of the last 24 hours around what we will be able to do and how we will be able to do it in the fall semester. As you know, our plan and all of our operational planning is around a normal classroom density in the fall and normal occupancy rates in our residence halls, traditional density in our dining halls, and in-person programming from a student life perspective. We are cherry picking the lessons learned from the pandemic in terms of some of the ways in which we will use technology, but from a student experience, it should be a very campus connected experience, both physically to the campus and to each other, faculty, staff, and students. So we'll watch very closely the health standards, the federal health standards, the state health standards, the expertise of our own colleagues, and make decisions accordingly, including the decisions that we're working on in real time today based on the governor's recent order. In February, we launched PRISM, and I'm happy to give you an update about that, the President's Initiative for Student Mental Health. We will finish populating the membership of that committee imminently. We have a draft now and expect to extend invitations in the next couple of days. We had hundreds of nominations for that committee, self and other nominations from students, faculty, clinicians, and staff. We are so grateful that so many people are so deeply committed to this work. And I want to specifically thank Dr. Tabitha Greer-Reed, Associate Dean for Graduate Education and Faculty Development in the College of Education and Human Development, and Maggie Towle, Senior Associate Vice President for Student Affairs. They are leading this. They are fantastic. They are the exact right people at the exact right time. And I look forward to what this means for our campus community. I also want to update you on PEAK, which is our program positioned for excellence, alignment, and knowledge. This is the effort that Myron Friends updated you on during the retreat, our effort aimed at continuous improvement practices and our effort to promote efficiency, which both of which are in commitment 5 of the system-wide strategic plan. So we've been gathering input from the entire university community, and we'll continue to do so until May 14th through what we're calling an administrative activity study. And that feedback will inform the work that Huron is doing as our consultants as they start to make recommendations. We invite your feedback. There is a form available on the PEAK Initiative website, which is very easy to get to off of the university website. This goes for everyone listening. Please let us know your thoughts on the prompts available to you via that form. And I want to thank Senior Vice President Franz and Interim Vice President for Human Resources, Ken Horstman, who are leading this work. I want to update you on some of our work around renamings and other educational initiatives associated with the board's April 2019 charge related to university history. We are very committed to this work and thank the board for charging us and creating the structure for us to undertake this work. We are developing and enhancing ongoing commemorations, more educational activities beyond what we've already offered, and also working on the possibility of permanent educational displays in the weeks and months ahead. On April 30th, we sponsor an event by the School of Music entitled Forging a Composer's Path in 2021 and Beyond with Gabriella Lania Frank, which is part of our Voice Art Community Series, a series offered by the President's Office, but in partnership with everyone across literally the system and in the community to look at how the arts and humanities create platforms for us to discuss social questions and social issues, including those related to our history as an institution. We're also looking forward to welcoming back National Book Award-winning poet Nikki Finney, who will be joining us on October 18th for a design thinking workshop as a follow-up to her March 5th reading and conversation related to her poetry inspired by these same questions. We will update you on future events, and please know you are invited and would be appreciated at all of them, including some that we expect this summer and our broader work as we move forward. We'll also look forward to following up with you as per your request during the diversity, equity, and inclusion overview last month at the retreat to give you a written update, sort of encapsulating all the broader diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts that we gave you the 30,000 foot look on last month. I have some personnel updates for you, members of the board. At the February meeting, I announced the search for the inaugural position, Senior Advisor to the President for Native American Affairs, which will report directly to me. I've accepted the recommendation of the search committee and offered the position to UMD and Harvard alumna Karen Diver, who has accepted the role. She has already started, hit the ground running, although her official start will be in a couple of weeks. She comes to us from the University of Arizona, where she was the Director of Business Development for the Native American Advancement Initiative. She previously served as a faculty member at UMD and at the College of St. Scholastica, and was a special assistant to President Obama on Native American Affairs, Native American Issues, which she held from 2015 to 2017. She also served as chairwoman of the Fond du Lac Band of the Lake Superior Chippewa. So I'm very excited about how her experience and expertise will help deepen and accelerate our work and commitment through Impact 2025 and beyond, and also strengthen our partnership and relationship with 11 sovereign tribal nations of Minnesota. I'm very grateful to Dr. Kat Hayes, Twin Cities College of Liberal Arts Professor and Search Committee Chair and General Angel on our shoulder in these broad efforts, and the members of the Search Committee for their willingness to serve in advocacy. The Minnesota Indian Affairs Council was also extremely helpful and a wonderful partner in all this work broadly and in the selection of Ms. Diver for this role. So thanks to everyone. With our search for the Vice President for Human Resources, the committee has reviewed the candidate pool. They held the confidential interviews, and last week our public finalists were virtually participating in the last phase of the interview process. So we should have an announcement there soon. My thanks to our co-chairs of that committee, College of Science and Engineering Dean Moss Cave and Rochester Chancellor Lori Carroll, and a large search committee who worked very hard and continued to provide feedback and really excellent insights on that search. And in Morris, in March, I updated you on Chancellor Baer's plans to retire at the end of the academic year. And I asked that Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Janet Schrunk Erickson serve as acting chancellor for a 2-year period. We have been very engaged with the Morris campus community and other stakeholders, and with their feedback and input and some of our insights by virtue of our work with Chancellor Baer and our understanding of national and local opportunities and challenges associated with leadership transitions, particularly in liberal arts. We announced the position that UMC Chancellor Mary Holdsclaus will assume, which is acting executive chancellor for the Crookston and Morris campuses. Her term will sync with acting chancellor Janet Schrunk Erickson's term so that we can serve the Morris campus effectively, help them through some of the headwinds that all colleges of their type are experiencing, help them advance some of the opportunities that they have that are robust and very specific and unique to them. So I'm very excited about this partnership, what it means for Morris, what it means for our systemness, playing to our strengths in service to that wonderful community. And then lastly, as we noted a few moments ago, after nearly 3 decades of distinguished university service, Vice President for Research, Chris Kramer, will be departing on June 1st out with a bang, with a much appreciated bang. And he will now become the Senior Vice President and Chief Research Officer for Underwriters Laboratories. Chris has been a great partner to me, and like so many across our university community, we are so grateful to him. We will miss him personally and professionally. And we're also very grateful to Michael Oakes for agreeing to serve as the Interim Vice President for Research. So I'm very confident that Chris has, as we all know, done everything right to pass the baton smoothly, and that we will see tremendous things come out of our university research enterprise as we launch that national search in the fall. So as winters become spring, lots of really fun things happen on campus. I want to give you some updates on some of my activities and then some of the campus good news. So since the March meeting, I've personally participated in a range of events that I want to make you aware of. I was on the Fulbright 75th anniversary panel on impact leaders. We did an event with our MacArthur Fellows, or better known as our Genius Grant recipients, Paul Danauer and Damian Fair. We had the public launch of BioMade. I joined with board leadership to engage with legislative colleagues about our new strategic plan and how the plan aligns with this year's biennial budget request, where we seek an increase of $46.5 million in O&M funding from the state, which is our lowest request in over 20 years, and a very carefully curated request for co-investment in how the university serves and partners with the state of Minnesota. I did all of the appropriate shared governance with University Senate, FCC, System Council, the deans, the foundations, board of directors, among others, and also engaged in several external boards that focus on issues related to the university, including ACE, Greater MSP, Medical Alley, the Minnesota Business Partnership, and I participated at annual and spring meetings for ACE, APLU, and the AAU. As you heard recently, I was honored to be named the Academic Vice Chair on the U.S. Council on Competitiveness. I'm taking over that role from Michael Crow at Arizona State, who has been a tremendous mentor and friend, and I've agreed to accept an invitation to serve on the Advisory Council to the Fulbright Scholar Program. So members of the board, as we close with our happy practice and with some shout outs, I want to give a shout out to Michael Tonry for receiving a Guggenheim Foundation Fellowship, and Professor Francis Shen for winning the American Law Institute's Early Career Scholars Medal. I want to give a shout out to UMD men's hockey team for reaching their 4th consecutive Final Four, Gopher football for having 2 top 75 NFL picks in the same draft for the first time since 1978, including Rashad Bateman as the first Gopher football player to be selected in the NFL first round in 15 years. And our national title winners, Sarah Bacon in diving, Cable Stevenson in wrestling, and Shane Wiskus in men's gymnastics. I also want to give a shout out to the longest tenured coach in the history of Gopher athletics, Terry Gamley, who announced her retirement after 44 seasons with swimming and diving. And then we have a short video shout out for you that includes some additional recognitions. I do love those. So lastly, shifting gears a little, I would like to recognize the life and loss of 1956 U of M alumnus, former U.S. President, 1984 Democratic nominee for president. And with that, Mr. Chair, I conclude my report. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you, President Gable, for that very, very fulsome report. Heartening, lots of progress in lots of good places. And I'm sure we all noted the very, very encouraging early news on enrollment. So it's great to see that. So I'll turn now to my report. First, I'd like to thank President Gable for her diligence in addressing the charges outlined in the April 2019 resolution related to institutional history. As you'll all recall, there were three charges, the first of which was to develop in the 2021 academic year ongoing commemorations, educational activities, or permanent displays to reflect the university's complex institutional history. And with the work, President Gable, that you've outlined in your report, this element of the resolution has been fulfilled. And as a board, we look forward to continued engagement with you in addressing our institutional history. Now, typically when we meet in May, the board recognizes and celebrates the faculty, staff, and students who've earned honors locally, nationally, and internationally over the past year. Because we aren't meeting in person, I just want to call your attention to this tremendous list of individuals. They're listed in the meeting docket, and they're also honored on a special page on the Board of Regents website. Their accomplishments are so valuable and worthy of celebration. And on behalf of the board and the entire university community, we congratulate all of the honorees. And really, just to underline what President Gable said, this is just a sample of the exceptional work of our university community. The honors and awards span across the breadth of disciplines the institution represents. So I encourage you all to read through this. It is very, very impressive. I also want to especially recognize one group, the student representatives to the Board of Regents. These individuals fulfill an important role in bringing the student voice to the board's deliberation. We appreciate their perspectives and their thoughtful comments, and the great effort and work that they put in for the board. This year, the following individuals served as student representatives: Jael Karandi from the Twin Cities campus, who served as the chair; Abdullah Ali served as vice chair and represented the Duluth campus; Sia Buter served as representative of graduate and professional students. From the Rochester campus, Paul Koch. Representing the Crookston campus, Kip Rotich. Rodrigo Tojo Garcia represented the Twin Cities campus. Riel Purdue Swanson served as a representative of graduate and professional students. And finally, Emily Whitcop from the Morris campus. So we so appreciate your work and your effort and your service as student representatives to the Board of Regents. So as we near the end of spring semester, as you heard, commencements are well underway. Several regents, myself included, are participating in close to 30 unique ceremonies across the university system. Some are in person, some virtual, some hybrid. No matter how you're celebrating, I just want to take a moment to congratulate all of our graduating students, and we wish you the very, very best for your future pursuits. And of course, a very special thank you to the faculty and the staff who guided all of our students through this past academic year. We want to thank you for your dedication, your persistence, your willingness to adapt in order to best serve our students during a very, very, very difficult period. We do thank you. So turning to other business this morning, I'm announcing the appointment of two committees. First, the nominating committee. Every 2 years, in accordance with our bylaws, the board convenes a nominating committee charged with recommending a slate of candidates to serve as board chair, vice chair, secretary, and treasurer. This year, the members will include Regent Hibsch, Regent McMillan, and Regent Davenport, who will serve as chair of the nominating committee. The committee will present its recommendations at the board's annual meeting on Friday, June 11th. The second committee is the Presidential Performance Review Committee. This committee is established each year in May for the purpose of evaluating the performance of the president. And this year, the committee will be composed of Regents Swigum, Regent Mayron, and myself. And I will act as chair of the committee, and as has been our practice for many, many years. We will deliver our report in July. That concludes my report this morning. Sadly, I don't have a video, so we'll continue on with our meeting agenda. Item 5 is the receive and file reports. Please note the reports in the docket material. And next, we'll consider the consent report. Is there a motion to approve the consent report?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Second. It's been moved and seconded. Are there any questions or comments on the consent report? And Mr. Steves, you'll have to help me. My raised hand feature eludes me this morning. So if you see anybody, let me know.
I'm not seeing any hands.
All right. So with there being no questions or comments, Mr. Steves will call the roll on the consent report.
On approval of the consent report, Regent Davenport.
Yes.
Regent Davenport votes yes. Regent Farnsworth.
Yes.
Regent Farnsworth votes yes. Regent Hibsch.
Yes.
Regent Hibsch votes yes. Regent Johnson.
Yes.
Regent Johnson votes yes. Regent Kenyanya.
Yes.
Regent Kenyanya votes yes. Regent Mayron.
Yes.
Regent Mayron votes yes. Regent McMillan.
Yes.
Regent McMillan votes yes. Regent Rocha.
Yes.
Regent Rocha votes yes. Regent Swigum.
Yes.
Regent Swigum votes yes. Regent Verhaelen.
Yes.
Regent Verhaelen votes yes. Chair Powell.
Yes.
Chair Powell votes yes. Mr. Chair, there are 11 in favor and 0 opposed.
All right. The consent report is approved. Thank you. Our next item is before us for action this morning. In March, we had a formal review of the proposed amendments to the Board of Regents policy, American Indian Advisory Boards. There have been no additional changes to the policy draft since that formal review in March. So before we turn to discussion, I'll entertain a motion to adopt the amendments to the Board of Regent policy, American Indian Advisory Board. Is there a motion?
Adoption.
Moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Thank you. Moved and seconded. Let's turn to discussion. Raise hand or alert Mr. Steves. And we'll see if we have anybody who would like to speak to this motion. And Brian, if you can just let me know who's showing up.
We have a Regent McMillan.
Regent McMillan, please.
Thank you, Chair Powell. And I think this is probably a question for President Gable. I'm all in favor of this. I can recall when we were working through in our old committee structure the day this was supposed to come before us, and it was pulled back in 2015 for, I guess, bluntly, lack of consultation with the American Indian community. So I'm very glad to see that it's before us. I support the structure. I support everything in the policy. My question is this: perhaps President Gable, you can kind of bring to life for us how the four system campus committees, advisory committees, will interact with you and the Twin Cities campus, and how you'll come to what I might call coordinated outcomes. I don't have any doubt that'll occur. I'm just curious with five of these, will that all roll up under your new position with Karen Diver, by the way, who I'm pleased to see that you've filled that role, or will this be independent of that?
Thank you for the question. Originally we would have had the five committees in advising on each campus, and we would have probably organically looked for interaction, given that at the end of the day, we do a lot of things with system council, system nests. I would have been reported to by the chancellors. I think we would have been fine. But in actual recognition of the concern that you raised, which we identified in the process, we've added an executive council. So there will be representation from each of the campus councils on an executive council that I will participate in. So we put some structure behind it just so that we could make sure that we were moving together synergistically, avoided redundancies, looked for how we could support each other because it's shared work in the aggregate, it's a shared mission, but its implementation is quite customized and tailored to the communities of each campus. And so we wanted to get the best of both worlds. And so we created the executive council.
That's outstanding. Thank you. You have my full support.
I'm not seeing any other hands at this moment, Chair Powell. Oh, we have Regent Farnsworth.
I think Chair Powell, I think you're on mute, but if you're okay, I'll go ahead.
Yes, please. Yes, go ahead.
Yes, thank you, Chair Powell. And just wanted to briefly comment, looking through this, that I think was appreciated and seen the consultation. This, of course, being a new member of the board, first time I've seen this and don't have the history with it going back to 2015 per se. But this seems like a really consultative process. Not only that, but also I think the policy language amendments themselves bring more clarity to what is obviously a really important structure for our university to continue to build upon and live up our mission of engaging with tribal nations. Just on a personal note, it's of particular importance to me, having recently discovered through a personal kind of personal ancestry process with my own personal history, discovering some Native American background myself, I'm particularly interested in this issue and look forward to continuing to support it and would echo Regent McMillan in his full support, offering my full support as well. This looks really fantastic. Thank you.
All right, good. Thank you, Regent Farnsworth. Regent Verhaelen.
Thank you, Chair Powell. And really, this is more asking permission of you if this is all right, but given that Vice President Goh and Director Johnson were so integral in helping get this across the line and work with President Gable on this, I just wanted to ask if it would be okay to ask those two gentlemen if there's anything additional they would like to say as we consider this policy going forward, or any other personal thoughts given their involvement in this process.
Sure. Thank you for that, Regent Verhaelen. Gentlemen, any additional comments that you would like to make?
Thank you, Chair Powell, and thank you, Regent Verhaelen, for your invitation. I echo the sentiments that have been made. I believe that President Gable's remarks this morning with the announcement of Karen Diver as Senior Advisor reflects the tremendous work and progress that has already been made. And these efforts, I will say, with your action, help us move towards our MPAC 2025 commitment and action to improve our relations with our Minnesota tribal nations. There is tremendous work ahead, but this is a good step in that direction. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Other comments? All right.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Nothing to add.
Yes. All right, thank you. All right, thanks for that. Thanks for that, Regent Verhaelen. I appreciate that. All right, Mr. Steves, I don't see any other raised hands. And so there being no other questions or comments, I will ask for the vote on this amendment to the Board of Regents policy, American Indian Advisory Boards.
On amendments to the board's policy on American Indian Advisory Boards, Regent Davenport.
Yes.
Regent Davenport votes yes. Regent Farnsworth.
Yes.
Regent Farnsworth votes yes. Regent Hipsch.
Yes.
Regent Hipsch votes yes. Regent Johnson.
Yes.
Regent Johnson votes yes. Regent Kenyanya.
Yes.
Regent Kenyanya votes yes. Regent Mayron.
Yes.
Regent Mayeron votes yes. Regent McMillan?
Yes.
Regent McMillan votes yes. Regent Rocha?
Yes.
Regent Rocha votes yes. Regent Swigum?
Yes.
Regent Swigum votes yes. Regent Verhaelen?
Yes.
Regent Verhaelen votes yes. Chair Powell?
Yes.
Chair Powell votes yes. Mr. Chair, there are 11 in favor and zero opposed.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Steve. So that resolution is adopted. Thank you, everybody. All right. Now let's turn to item eight. And this continues our series with our system campus leaders. Today, we have Chancellor Mary Holtzclaus with us to lead a discussion of the Crookston campus strategy. Before we turn it over to her, I believe President Gabel would like to make some introductory and framing remarks. So President Gabel, first over to you.
Thank you, Chair Powell, Vice Chair Swigum, and members of the board. With the board's approval of the metrics and measures for MPAC 2025 February meeting, the university is in full swing implementing the plan. So Crookston, the second of the campuses to present how their strategy aligns with their Impact 2025 system-wide plan, following Rochester's presentation at the March meeting. Duluth and Morris will present their respective plans over coming meetings. So members of the board, one of the distinct benefits of Impact 2025 is having a system plan around which all of our campuses can coalesce, and yet we can recognize, acknowledge, and amplify the unique identities and opportunities for each campus, as well as the strategies that meet the needs of their respective communities. Under Chancellor Holtzclaw's innovative leadership, Crookston has shifted from a broad and academic process-oriented planning approach to one centered in action and results under the theme of focus and finish. During the past 4 years, strategic priorities were honed from 7 to 3 with greater attention to goals, metrics, and implementation. They include campus enrollment growth and retention, diversity, equity, and belonging, and Golden Eagle Pride, relationships, and engagement. Embedded in this work is Crookston's important online presence and leadership, which is invaluable and informs the work of the rest of the university system. So I thank Chancellor Holtzclaw in advance and the entire Crookston community for their important engagement and insights throughout the strategic planning process. They've been very helpful with all of our work, including my dating back from my inaugural visit back in fall 2019, and have been real partners in how we faced the broad challenges of the pandemic and have offered their expertise and strength as we've leveraged more and more technology and think strategically about the future of the use of the technology. Through Crookston's efforts and in so many other ways, MPAC 2025 exemplifies that we are five campuses strong, working together as one system, and that we all can come together to ensure that our best days lie ahead. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Chancellor Holtzclaus.
All right. Thank you, President Gabel. Chancellor Holtzclaus, over to you.
Chair Powell and members of the Regents, thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today about how our strategic plan for the University of Minnesota Crookston aligns with the system-wide strategic plan. The University of Minnesota system benefits from the unique and distinct identities of each of its five campuses, just as the campuses benefit our shared identity as members of the University of Minnesota system. One of the aspects that makes Crookston campus unique is our long emphasis on management and planning. In fact, for almost every major on our campus, there's a required management and strategic planning course. And as we as a campus are also true to that tenet, management and strategic planning are very important aspects of our campus culture. It's not just an exercise for us every couple of years. Throughout the years, the University of Minnesota Crookston has been continuously engaged in broad and academic process-oriented planning. Next slide, please. Following multiple years, as President Gabel just said, of a continuing planning process, we shifted our energy to implementation and results, as she also mentioned, under our theme, Focus and Finish. As we made this shift to practice several years ago, we retired a few strategic priorities and narrowed our number to 3 and ensured that every one of our priorities is a SMART goal: specific, measurable, obtainable, realistic, and time-bound. In short, the past 3 years have been years of action that set us up well with the strategic alignment exercise. In fact, next slide, please. Almost on every doorstep on our campus, we have a Focus and Finish poster reminding us of the common priorities that we've outlined in our campaign. UMCSUN's current strategic plan focuses on three priorities: campus enrollment growth and greater retention, diversity, equity, and belonging, Golden Eagle pride, relationships, and engagement. Though not part of our formal campus planning, UMN Crookston's experience and history with both online education and fiscal stewardship also overlay commitments identified in the Impact 2025. Later in the presentation and in your docket on page 55, you can see the goals and specific metrics we have established for each of these three strategic priorities. In the coming year, we'll update these metrics and most likely establish new ones for online education and fiscal stewardship. Next slide, please. Our three strategic priorities and two additional commitments to online education and fiscal stewardship align with the five commitments of the UMN system-wide M2025 plan, as shown in this slide. These are further detailed in page 39 of the docket, so I'll touch on just a few of the highlights for you. Commitment number one, student success, that's our first priority of enrollment management. At its core, our enrollment management priority is grounded in student success. That's why we launched our first test optional review process, because after careful analysis of our student data showed that high school grades are a much stronger predictor of student success at Crookston, while ACT scores sometimes are spurious. Additionally, holistic measures allows us to discover talent that other regional institutions may miss. Increasing yield and decreasing summer melt has been a key to growing enrollment over the last several years, and we've done this through concerted efforts to begin preparing students to be successful in college from the moment that they apply to us. Further, we've enhanced our efforts on retention as a central measure of student success, which leads to increased enrollment. We align both our third strategic priority, Golden Eagle Pride, relationships and engagement, and our commitment to online programs with Impact 2025, commitment two, discovery, innovation, and impact, as well as to commitment number three, the intersections. In terms of discovery, innovation, and impact, every one of our campus students is required to engage in either an undergraduate research project or a professional internship. These experiences allow our own students to be at the forefront of discovery. For more than 20 years, our online programs have primarily supported adult learners with professional experience. Thus, we've addressed innovation and impact through engaging online pedagogy. Over the last several years, we've worked very closely with UMN Center for Educational Innovation to enhance further instructional approaches characterized by high degrees of engagement and instructor presence to ensure students can apply the content they learn in class today into their professional lives tomorrow. We intersect the intersections on several fronts. In the area of health education, for example, we have a strong and growing program in health management that is one of the few online programs accredited by the National Association of Long-Term Care Administrative Boards, or NAB. The intersections of food and agriculture have long been strong foci on our campus. We have excellent agricultural curriculum with two agriculture degrees available online. As you heard the other day at the retreat, we're working with colleagues in the Twin City to develop some new and innovative programs such as Farm to Tablet. We're also looking at ways we can more fully respond to your comments about creating opportunities to build upon the youth's strength in sustainable development and becoming a leader in the impacts of climate change. Commitment four, community and belonging, aligns with our second strategic priority, diversity, equity, and belonging. Diversity, equity, and belonging focuses on representational diversity, student success, and campus climate. We've unearthed some unfortunate situations when our students didn't feel appreciated, nor did they feel like they belonged. And we know that belonging is closely associated with student learning and persistence. We're making it our job number one to address these issues early when we are aware of them and determine strategies to address and correct them. During the past year, we've stepped up frequency and depth of professional development efforts addressing equity and inclusion with my senior leadership team and the Vice Chancellor's Strategic Administrative Leadership Team, as well as our enrollment group, student engagement, wellness, athletics, and university relations. A central theme through all of these experiences has been addressing microaggressions, namely how our actions, while generally well-intended, can be experienced by others as being hurtful, exclusionary, or worse. Lastly, the Impact Commitment 5 of this fiscal stewardship aligns with our commitment of the same name in our plan. UMN Crookston has right-sized its staffing over the last several budget cycles. We are running an extremely lean operation. Whereas our enrollment over the past 2 years dropped by 4.5%, full-time faculty FTE are down 8%, and the total number of UMN Crookston employees is down 13%. Yet while our campus enrollment has dropped, the average student credit hours per class has increased by 4%, meaning that not only are our faculty teaching more courses, they're teaching more students in each of their classes. Not surprisingly, the 2019 University Performance and Accountability Report shows that UMN Crookston has the highest number of students per employee and the lowest percentage of employees who are in leadership within the system. And this data does not account for the recent reopening. Next slide, please. I'll come back to these commitments in a few moments and we'll address some later. But first wanted to give you a little more context of some of the opportunities, issues, and greater in-depth look at our students. I think this will be helpful to you in the future as we plan together our next chapter for the success of the University of Minnesota Crookston. As noted previously, our first strategic priority is enrollment management. In short, we have two student populations, the traditional 18 to 22-year-old college on-campus student population, and our online students, whose average age is 32. Next slide, please. First, let's explore our on-campus students. 52% of our students come from Greater Minnesota, and an additional 16% come from North Dakota and South Dakota, Iowa, and Wisconsin. They like the small campus environment, and approximately half of these students are enrolled in agriculture and natural resources. As indicated on the slide, 42% of our on-campus students are first-generation students. 31% are Pell eligible, 14% are students of color, and 8% are international students, which is the highest on-campus rate for any U of M campus. In contrast to the rest of the system, 74% of our students of color are also Pell eligible, first gen or both, meaning that our students of color are nearly 25% more likely to have multiple marginalized identities than students of color across the rest of the University of Minnesota system. Moving forward, we will need to provide faculty and staff professional development to ensure that we are understanding and meeting the needs of these students. Additionally, we are enacting a comprehensive diversity hiring plan to ensure that future additions to our faculty and staff really reflect the demographics of our emerging student population. Next slide, please. Our adult online students are very focused. In fact, if you forgive my play on words, they're focused on finishing their college degree. Nearly all of our online students are non-traditional adult learners. 60% attend part-time and 85% enter as transfer students, which significantly increases the demand on the professional advisors who support them. Many of them also have already exhausted their federal college aid and are paying for the education out of their pockets, while a few receive tuition reimbursement from their employers, which also includes some of our own employees from the University of Minnesota. Several years ago, we determined we needed to know more about our online students. So we administered the Noel Levitz Priority Survey for online learners to benchmark ourselves with others in the world of online education. And we also conducted focus groups with these students. Among the findings were the top two reasons why these students enroll in the University of Minnesota Crookston online program is because of the prestige and the reputation of the University of Minnesota degree and the flexibility to complete programs offered through asynchronous delivery. Next slide, please. Consider together, our total on-campus and online student numbers have remained relatively flat over the last 8 years. Although it's early, our projections for 2021 are flat to perhaps a small increase in enrollment. Some context though might be important to demonstrate why this really reflects progress in our enrollment. As many of you are aware, we made the decision to eliminate our fall program in late 2019. In the previous 5 years, we brought in an average of 440 new students each year. 405 of them were non-football players. Thus, when we brought in 422 new students last year, it was actually an increase of previous years. And our early projections for fall are that we will maintain that increase. Further, by fall 2022, we anticipate our strategies of club sports talking and our acceptance in the top level competition equestrian program, NCEA, and others will help offset the loss of football. Our preliminary international recruitment indicates that there's strong pent-up demand, and we've invested heavily in establishing new global partnerships over the past year. While we don't expect to see significant results yet this fall, we hope the effects of the pandemic will soon wane, leading to increased returns on our investment in international recruitment. As I previously mentioned, increasing yield and decreasing summer melt have been core strategies for our on-campus enrollment, and data shows that these have been effective strategies for us. Of those students we admit that do not yield, we do lose most of them to the Twin Cities and Duluth. And there is an impact when people change their target numbers and choose to increase the number of students that they admit. As noted in our prior reports to the board, our goal is to achieve total degree-seeking enrollment of 2,100 students. To reach this aggressive enrollment goal, we'll need to continue the pathway we've begun, which includes execution of strong marketing strategies. We've been focusing on knowing who our students are and how we reach those new students. The Systems Discover the U of M for You campaign, which ran this past fall, focuses on juniors and seniors and was additive to us and allowed us to really shift our limiting marketing efforts to our online students. Next slide, please. More so than other campuses within the University of Minnesota system, though, UMN Crookston and Duluth are highly dependent on enrollment to fund our budget. Given our small size, a fluctuation of a small number of students can have a significant impact on our budget in any given year. And given the demographics of our students, as I've just described them, volatility in our budget can threaten our ongoing efforts to help our students discover their potential and succeed. Next slide, please. That's why we're focusing so intently on marketing. We have a quality product. It's priced competitively, but if people aren't aware of it, it's for naught. Recent analysis by the Third Way price to earnings premium, for example, shows that UMN Crookston graduates recoup their tuition investment after just 2 years, which is second among the UMN institutions and eighth among Minnesota colleges and universities. When answering the question, is Crookston the U of M for you in our new system-wide marketing campaign, we have answered with words real, hands-on, and ready. The education our student receives is real and hands-on, and when our students graduate, they are ready, whether for graduate school or the workplace. Our employers and follow-up studies with graduate programs confirms this. Our students are highly sought after by regional employers. We simply don't have enough graduates in this region right now to meet their demands. The Discover the U of M for You marketing campaign has been a great success for the University of Minnesota. And next slide, please. As by providence, it seems that the Discover the U of M for You fits perfectly into our award-winning I Am Crookston campaign we launched 16 months ago. The M is strong, well-known, and a prestigious moniker in the marketplace, and we want to ensure that when people think of Crookston, they think of the Block M as well. Please notice the images, and I'm going to ask you to particularly notice the image of the horse there in the I Am Crookston. We'll talk about that in a moment. Next slide, please. Marketing is important, and even small investments have made a significant impact. We've been steady in enrollment numbers over the last 3 years against some pretty tough odds, but we're doing more. A few years ago, as you'll recall, we came to you to talk about marketing some of our niche, high quality programs. Among them is our equestrian major, and that strategy's paid off pretty well. The number of incoming students in equine major in 2016 was 4. and the number of incoming students in equine major in 2019 was 31. So within our budget compact proposal, we propose to build upon the I Am Crookston campaign. And remember that horse I just noticed you to notice in the Block M? We want to apply a lot of these niche strategies with our other distinctive academic programs. But while we recognize that we must also be creating more and stronger pathways and need to focus on the demographics of the region. The students K through six in the Crookston Public Schools are from Latinx background. It's similar to slightly higher percentage in the Cathedral Parochial School in Crookston. We are within an hour of two tribal nations, White Earth and Red Lake Nation, and Leech Lake isn't much further away. We also have a large number of Somali youth moved to the region. And as is the case throughout the Midwest and Northern Plains, the future of Northwest Minnesota will be much more racially diverse than presently. And we must not only recruit for this reality, but we must also prepare our graduates to live and work within it. We know we can't stand back idly and wait for these students to come to us. If we don't start reaching out to them and helping these students envision themselves as perhaps going to college someday, it may not happen. We know that college age formation in the student mindset begins to develop within the middle elementary years. Through partnerships across the U with groups such as 4-H and the Office of Public Engagement and regional partners, particularly our tribal nations, Latinx-based organizations such as Auster and others, we're actively engaging and programming and outreach. This past year, we launched a grant-funded Latinx-based business assistance program called Mano Amiga, and are working with White Earth to educate more students in Head Start-funded program. We've also reached out to our donors and asked for their assistance to provide financial aid and resources to help our students, such as international students and online students, who may not be eligible for traditional financial aid. The need and assistance for these two groups is real. They cannot be forgotten. In our recent admission collaboration with the University of Minnesota Morris, we'll be sharing admissions counselors, which we hope will provide expanded coverage and pick up more efficiencies. For instance, recently, we just worked with a software platform provider, and both were able to realize savings by negotiating together. Next slide. Obviously, though, we're not going to be successful in reaching our enrollment targets if we only work on recruitment. If we could eliminate the current first to second year retention rate gaps between students of color and white students, for example, we could add more than 25 students to our on-campus enrollment over the next 4 years without any new increase in student enrollment. For a campus our size, that would be a significant increase that would result in more than $250,000 in tuition revenue alone. More importantly, it's the right thing to do by students, and it would engender confidence for future generations of prospective students that access at the University of Minnesota Crookston is not just about getting to college, it's about getting through and moving on to a brighter future. Over the past 2 years, we've launched first-year seminar courses required for all of our new on-campus students, and our Student Success Center serves as the hub of programs and services that promotes holistic student success grounded in equity and inclusion. Although we've had significant staff reductions in our Student Success Center, we've narrowed the gap in first to second-year retention for students of color by 40%. Next slide, please. Our goals of diversity, equity, and belonging fall largely into two areas. The first of these is to increase the racial representation diversity on our campus. Specifically, our metric is to achieve an applicant pool that mirrors the racial demographics of graduates from the University of Minnesota's public high schools. Once we achieve this goal for our applicant pool, we will need to eliminate yield rate gaps to ensure our incoming class reflects the applicant pool and thus the state of Minnesota. We've already surpassed similar metrics for first generation college students, Pell eligible students, and students from greater Minnesota. Also related to this representational diversity is eliminating retention and graduation gaps between students of color and white students, as discussed on the previous slide. When considering students from greater Minnesota, they actually outperform their peers from the metro area and beyond Minnesota at the Crookston campus. And though not completely eliminated, the gap of first-generation students and Pell-eligible students are relatively small. A second goal on our campus is to strengthen the overall campus climate as reflected in routine administrations of the National Survey of Student Engagement, or NISE, and the Intercultural Development Inventory on campus. These instruments, along with ongoing qualitative focus groups and related metrics, help us to assess our progress towards creating a campus culture that's equitable and promotes a sense of belonging. To achieve the desired results, we are investing in a range of efforts, identity-based programming initiatives, curricular advancements, and support services. Next slide, please. Thank you. Golden Eagle Pride relationships and engagement. We recognize that we need for the region to see the University of Minnesota Crookston as their university, the university they're proud of and want to be part of, the university where the region wants to send their sons, daughters, and grandchildren to. And quite frankly, somewhere, we either lost that affinity to the region or perhaps it never existed. I don't know which one it is, and it really doesn't matter, but what does matter is that we are working very hard to be strong community partners. To help with this effort, a year and a half ago, we put to work some philanthropic funds that had been idle for a little too long to create the Vadean Center for Rural and Economic Development and Strategic Partnerships. The center has a focus to advance relationships and engagements in the region. Next slide. Specifically, the work that this group is doing is going towards the APOU's Innovation and Economic Prosperity IEP designation, which has as its focus helping universities to be truly engaged and to be an asset to their local communities. Our athletic facilities are very important to the region. We frequently host tournaments up regional areas, and with HEPR funding and private funding, we were able to upgrade our Lee Saker Gymnasium this past year, which is a central place for weekend use and other use when our own teams are not playing. Additionally, we're enhancing the profile of our athletic offerings, both intercollegiate and club level, to build success. As mentioned in the docket materials, we've added club hockey, club track, NCAA women and men's cross country in the last several years. Next slide, please. Just as these ambitious goals create opportunities, they also create challenges we must face head on. One of these areas I haven't touched upon yet is that of online learning. UMN Crookston, as President Gable introduced us, has been a leader in online undergraduate education for 20 years, and we have experiences with adult learners and meeting workforce needs. Because of the pandemic, many universities now have experience and increased confidence in their own online learning capabilities. Going forward, we will need to make additional and significant investments to maintain our excellence. Specifically, we will need to continue to help our faculty grow and develop their expertise and ensure we are using the methods and approaches used in adult education that are really directed towards self-actualization, gaining experience, and problem solving. Lastly, we've spoken about this earlier, but we must consider the financial aid of adult learners. They are different, and our federal and state financial aid systems often don't meet their needs. Next slide, please. The commitment, Minnesota ag and food area. Agriculture and food systems are vitally important to the University of Minnesota Crookston. As noted previously, approximately half of our on-campus students major in fields in agriculture or natural resources. Some of these programs, quite honestly, need significant infrastructure investments. They're expensive, and yet our students need to work with modern equipment and technology to prepare for the workforce and for meeting the needs of the region. While there certainly is a role for business and industry and philanthropy to help out, we need strong core programming to augment their investment. This photo is actually from our Ag Systems Management Program, which is an essential program that supports students of several other agriculture majors too. Too often, our students work with equipment, engines, technologies from the 70s and 80s, which is not really cutting it in today's world. Next slide, please. As I near the conclusion of our presentation, it's also important to note several metrics within the Impact 2025 that will demand new investments by UMM Crookston. For example, We're excited about the possibilities of leveraging system collaboration and as such the system-wide mental health initiative. However, a number of our systems are dated. We typically rely on paper filing systems, and we've not increased student service fees for mental health at the same rate as other campuses over many years. We'll need to invest roughly $150,000 annually to support our students and engage in shared mental health initiatives. We will also need to allocate additional staffing simply to comply with reporting requirements as we all work towards a Carnegie Community Engagement designation and the Sustainable Development Metrics, Commitment 3, Goal 2. And advancing our work in these areas is going to require additional allocation of human resource time to collect and report data. Among our large proportion of Pell-eligible students, their many financial needs are greater than the tuition. A significant number of our on-campus students have their full tuition covered by federal and state aid, but unfortunately surf from place to place, live in low-income housing, and face food insecurity. And nearly one-third of our online students would qualify for Pell grants, but they're no longer eligible for additional federal and state aid. These students would benefit greatly when they obtain a University of Minnesota degree, but we need to do more to help them to reduce and overcome financial barriers to their achievement so that they can have that degree from the University of Minnesota. Next slide, please. So like many of these students I just mentioned, we are pragmatists. We understand there are limited resources and priorities have to be made. We've worked hard on our campus to be very lean and determine our priorities. We are proud of the work we do, and we believe we've become particularly adept at securing a strong return on almost every investment that's made by our institution, no matter how small. We're equally proud to be part of the University of Minnesota system, and like each of our other four campuses, contribute something unique that makes the University of Minnesota system truly exceptional. My team, including John Hoffman, Vice Chancellor for Academic and Student Affairs, Sue Erickson, Head of our Institutional Research, and Tricia Sanders, Director of our Finance, and I are happy to answer your questions now.
All right. Very good, Chancellor. Thank you for that very good presentation. Really appreciate the focus and the way you're addressing, you know, the challenges and the progress that you're making. I see a few hands popping up here, and while we're waiting for more to come up, maybe I'll start off with a question. Can you tell us more? I know that you're expecting actually faster growth with the online student population. Can you tell us a bit more about, you know, what those students, you know, what they look like, if you will, the size of the market, what it is that triggers their decision to come back to school, the kinds of programs that they tend to favor. Just give us a little better feel for that, since they are so critical to your future.
Thank you for the great question, Regent Powell. Our online students, for the most, the majors and the areas that they're most interested in taking are business. Most of them, more than half of our students, about three quarters of our students, are business majors. And when they come back to us, they tell us from the research that we've done that initially they look around for an online program. They find that then they find this one from the University of Minnesota. And with so many of our students, our online students from Minnesota, more than three quarters of them, they immediately see the opportunity, as we talked about, the importance of the University of Minnesota degree. The students, when they come to us, as I said, majority of them have significant transfer credits and they're looking to finish. As we said, they're very focused. They want to get through. Initially, several years ago, they were taking six credits or two classes a semester. And now we're seeing that they're taking sometimes as many as four. The average number of credits is 9 credits per semester. So they're very interested in ensuring that they're going to get that degree as soon as possible. They also like the asynchronous part because, as we've indicated, probably more than three quarters of them are employed. And so the asynchronous aspect of it allows them to come on at their time. And then I've heard from focus groups that we've done, particularly with a number of our students, they're also just so impressed and like the access with our faculty members. I remember one student who told me it was 11:30 and I was working on a a project and I type something in, 11:33, the instructor is back to me. So although they don't expect 24/7 response, they recognize that our faculty are very responsive to their needs.
Great, thank you.
Question?
It does. I'm sure there are a bunch more coming now. Thank you, Chancellor. So I see a number of hands raised, and we'll start with Mary, Regent Davenport, and then we'll go on to Regent Hipsch and Regent McMillan. But Mary, over to you.
Thanks, Chair Powell, and thank you, Chancellor Holzclaus, for an excellent presentation. I liked your focus on marketing and retention as one point of many, and especially as you related it to diversity and your K-12 partners and relationships. I've noticed a proliferation of North Dakota, especially UND and NDSU billboards across the state, and I've seen some River Falls billboards in the south here. Marketing's expensive, I know, but it sounds like you're seeing some return on investment. So my question is, are you able, I know budgets are a constraint, are you able to market in North Dakota? South Dakota is a competitor in ag. River Falls, I'm thinking especially around your niche areas in agriculture and food. Are you able to market in North Dakota, South Dakota, Wisconsin?
Chancellor.
Regent Davenport, thank you for the question. We are able to market. As you indicated, it's expensive, and so we have to prioritize. And so frequently, what we have found to be most cost-effective actually is digital marketing. We do a few billboards just because everybody knows we need a little bit of presence, but we've really gone to focusing on the student, and the students are more digitally inclined, and we would like to be able to do more in North Dakota. North Dakota is the second largest state that we have students from after Minnesota, though, so it's a very important market to us. One other, unfortunately, market we haven't been able to work in the last year and a half is in Canada, because we also have a number of students who come to us from Manitoba. And it's just been difficult for us to both market as well as have our Canadian students be able to get to us easily over the last couple of years. So we all look forward to the pandemic maybe changing some of those demographics and opportunities for us. I'm going to tell you that we wish we had more money available to let people know about the treasure that we are. And that's, as I said, the pragmatic aspect of us. We recognize that there's only so much available. The University of Minnesota campaign that was done last year was very helpful to us, where we everybody got to decide what was the right M for them. And so we hope that we can continue and all of us be able to continue to work together from a system-wide perspective. That answers your question for you.
Follow up, Regent Davenport?
No, thank you. I'm impressed with the progress the campus has made over the last, especially several years. Thanks.
Okay,
thank you, Regent Davenport. I would like to make just a comment about, just as we heard the president talk about, there's been an increase in enrollment in the health sciences. In other industries and other fields, we also see the same thing. And so the last several years, with the exception of the last, year or so, we've actually seen a decrease in our enrollment in our agriculture and natural resources, which again reflects what's been happening in agriculture.
All right, very good. Thank you. Regent Hipsch.
Thank you, Chair Powell, and great report, Chancellor. I really think Crookston is a gem of a school, and we know that agriculture is changing, and we're going to have to grow more food with a lot less resources. We all know that, and you're filling that void. And we know that Crookston is a gem, and also it's a gem for the community too. I know you do a lot of things. I attended a housing summit there one time and had great information, and it really kicked off housing in our area. So I want to thank you for that. But regard to marketing, I'm in agreement with Regent Davenport. I don't think I'm going to just be pretty blunt and say, I don't think $100,000 is enough to market the school. I think we're, if we're going to get get moving to those enrollment numbers, we're going to have to spend a lot more because marketing is expensive and we know how important it is for our businesses and whatever. And the colleges are no different. And we're going to have to market with the big dogs if we're going to have to spend with them. So anyways, I just want you to comment on that. And the other thing I want to just leave you with, I really like the club trap that you're doing. It really appeals to a lot of the kids in our area. We have just a lot of trap shooters and a lot of outdoors people here, and they really love that. So thank you for that.
Thank you. Thanks, Regent Hibbs. So Regent or Chancellor Holtz-Claus, over to you. And by the way, Chancellor, I mean, feel free to toss these to your other members of your team if you'd like to.
Thank you very much, Regent Hibbs, for the question, and Regent Powell. I agree with you that marketing is a good investment. And as I said, we are trying to, we've taken every dollar that we can find to try to put that towards our priority of enrollment management in the last several years. And you're absolutely right that we do need to ensure that we are doing everything we can. As we all know, we all see those billboards and other digital marketing that comes up on our computers every day from our competitors. And so it's very important that we look at this, I think, too, from a system-wide, how we can all leverage our funding the best. And in regard to our TRAP program, I'm going to put a plug into them. They have ranked number two, even though they're only 2 years in their program in their club over the last both years. They've been ranking number two. With that. And so we're very proud of the accomplishment that they've been able to do. And these students, again, it's a very, as you said, Regent Hibbs, it's a very, very synergistic fit for many of our students.
Great. Thank you. Follow up, Regent Hibbs?
No, thank you.
Okay, that's good. All right, Regent McMillan.
There we go. Yeah, thanks, Chancellor Holtz-Claus, for that comprehensive look at what's before you, what lies ahead, where you're putting your resources. It'll come as no surprise to anybody that I am very, very interested in system-wide enrollment strategy, and President Gable has been great about making that a priority for our discussions. And as you work on coordinated admissions across Morris and the Crookston campuses, I trust you'll be back to us to talk about lessons learned. And while you're doing it, please use what you learned to inform the broader system enrollment debate and how we better coordinate the admission process. You know, talk to your friends at Duluth too, because I heard you at one point say that when you're talking about melt or lost enrollment, it's the Twin Cities and Duluth where folks go. And if you talk to Chancellor Black's team, it's the Twin Cities where people go. So this sense of cascading consequences of what we do on the Twin Cities campus and what happens elsewhere, I'm always interested in that and what we can do as a board with President Gable and her team to not make things worse for our system while we focus on the Twin Cities, always important. So my message is, please come back to us with what it is you learn, as you probably more than anybody else know, to date, you bring two together and try to work together on those two campuses. Here's a question though. I applaud your focus on retention, and it's a big issue at another of our Duluth as well, and ground made in better retention outcomes is more than a one-for-one offset, as you said, with regard to recruiting and this whole marketing discussion, which I totally believe in as well. But as you look at your faculty, and are you pretty dependent on, what's your term to tenured faculty or tenure track faculty mix, and how important are term faculty as you get into delivering that education mission? Because what I'm learning is that the term faculty are just critically important in terms of retaining students. If a first-year student has a great experience in a class that's designed for first years and taught by a term faculty member, and then they're not there the next year, that has brutal implications for retention. So give me a little flavor for retention and how it relates to your faculty mix, if that matters. And then lastly, build tuition into this thing too. Is competitiveness of your tuition rate an issue when it comes to retention and recruitment? Or I know yours is the lowest. I think you're 12 plus and everybody else is north of 13, but I just don't know. I know the Dakotas have been coming up and probably getting close to 10,000 now, but we're still more expensive. So you don't have to say anything about coordinated admissions. Just come back to that. But retention and tuition competitiveness are I'm very interested in. Thanks.
Thank you, Regent McMillan. Yeah, Chancellor.
Thank you, Regent McMillan. I am going to make a comment about the system part, and then I'm going to ask Vice Chancellor for Academic and Student Affairs to answer your question. And the first question, the first comment about system-wide and the part that I think we all need to focus on is that we know almost 30% of Minnesota high school students leave the state of Minnesota to go to other states. And so while we never want to compete amongst ourselves for those students, I think that these campaigns can do an excellent job of making people aware who are current, those students, those 30% who are currently leaving to stay in Minnesota and finding the right end for them. And so that's the really the focus of us looking from the system-wide marketing strategy to go forward. So I did want to comment on that because that to me is the part that we're letting too many of our students leave the state of Minnesota. And I'm so glad that we are beginning to address that. And with that, I will turn it over to Vice Chancellor Hoffman to answer your specific questions.
All right, Vice Chancellor, please. Might be muted.
We might just need a moment to get him connected.
Okay. I will begin to answer the first part of that question, if you'll allow me then, please. And the first part of the question that you ask is how important are our P&A faculty and the impact that they have on students. And we they're very important, and they're very, and I will let Vice Chancellor talk about the percentages of P&A to our tenured faculty. But for the most part, many of our P&A faculty have been with us for, you know, 15, 20 years. We have some retirements, some have been coming up. So we've been very fortunate to have a long-term P&A faculty and those that have a really strong impact. Although I will admit there are occasionally some scrambles at the last minute where we are in the last, you know, 2 or 3 months where perhaps we're looking for adjunct or P&A faculty to fill a class or two. For the most part, many of our individuals have been with us quite some time. Vice Chancellor Hoffman? Technology is wonderful, isn't it, when it works?
I'm being told we're having some issues connecting. I'm so sorry.
Okay.
All right. Well, we'll, you know, we can, we'll come back.
Come back or I'll pick it up offline. Yeah. That's fine. You've covered the key points there, yeah. Chancellor Holzblaus. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, you know, and remind me to, you know, well, I'll try to go back if we can get the Vice Chancellor you know, hooked in here. But meanwhile, I'm going to move on to Regent Swigum, who is the next in line with his hand up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And let me second Regent Hoops' comments about this Crookston, the college being a gem, and yourself, Chancellor Holzblaus, as being a gem within the gem of the college. I don't want to dump on you on enrollment, but it sounds like after following up on Regent Davenport and Regent McMillan and Regent Hips, we're all worried about enrollment a little bit. You and I have emailed back and forth a little bit about this, and I've spoken with Vice Chancellor Hoffman about it. But you yourself in your presentation used the words lost affinity to the region, I think is the words you used, Mary. And I'm concerned. It always worried me when I look at politicians who would win their election, but lose in their home area, their home district, where people knew them the best. It always raised concerns to me about that individual. Let me be a little challenging to you in regards to the lost affinity to the region. I noticed that in your graduating class this last year, or just last week, by the way, there was not one student from Ada, one student from East Grand Forks, not one student from Fauston, not one student from Thief River Falls, all within a 20 minutes to 40 minutes of the town of Crookston. That's lost affinity to the region. And you've responded to it. You've talked about outreach. You've talked about college age formation outreach. Give me a little bit more, Mary. Give me a little bit more in regards to the affinity to the region. How, if you've lost it, why, and how we're going to win it back? Because you got to get students from East Grand Forks, and you got to get students from Ada. And I know you know that, but give me the confidence that we're moving in that direction.
Thank you, Regent. Right.
Yeah, Chancellor.
Thank you very much, Regent Swigum, for that question. And yes, we, as you noted in our graduations, that there were not individuals from that. So I also noticed it when I came 4 years ago and said, where are our students from our region? Why are they not coming to us? And so that really helped to inform our third priority, which was engagement. I put on took individual who was a very well-known in the community and had her move her responsibilities to be director of outreach and engagement as a direct report to me. We have been the last several years, particularly trying to use our athletic programs to bring people in. So last year or 2 years ago, everybody in the community, all of the athletes and most of the faculty, we were like going, if I could use your phrase as a politician, going door to door, handing out free passes for people to come to our athletic events. I remember we had one night when there weren't enough parking spaces. And so it's just continually and constantly being a community partner, being present. We go now to the various city council meetings of our communities. I recently was able to bring a small business development person that serves the region. It's just continually every day going and thinking of ways that we can be more actively engaged and involved. Our commitment to the high school has changed. We were not as actively recruiting several years ago in our local high schools, and so we've made that a priority. I tell our admissions counselors they need to know the counselors in every one of our local school districts. We have to have a presence. As you know, it's consistent, constant, and always being involved in that. So it wasn't, you know, as I said, we looked at that and go, this is not right. There had always been what people used to tell me, there was this imaginary line where the railroad tracks ran, and that's where the university began. And then on the other side is where the community was. So we've been doing things like dine around town. So we get our students to come into the community, ran that. Fortunately, this past year, we weren't able to, but in previous years, we have a bus system now that we have our students go into Crookston, go into East Grand Forks. You know, we're just trying a lot of those different strategies, recognizing if we have literally enough plates spinning that we will be able to begin to impact that. And so that's what we're working towards. We welcome new ideas. That's also why I brought on, I made a reference to the Dean Center for Philanthropic Funds. Those have been sitting there for quite some time. And I said, we need to put those to use. For one thing, we know that every donor wants their funds put to use. And so they've been sitting there idle too long. And so we now have two individuals who are focusing on economic and community development, working with our extension program together so that we're outreaching appropriately and finding ways, for instance, for our students to be more engaged in the businesses, we're trying to get our marketing students to help, you know, do the websites, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And just lots of ideas to get a lot of things going so that eventually, I hope 4 years from now, and we'll begin to see it in the next couple of years, that when you're looking at those students that are graduating, you're seeing Boston, Ada, East Grand Forks, and Crookston students are in that graduating class. Just one other thing too, we've also been working really closely with our businesses in the areas, particularly for online students. And we have some, we need to have more success, but we've had some very good success. We have some students who, online students from that work in Crookston and are online students because they work during the day and they have found to get their degree that way was the best way. So welcome all new ideas. We're very involved right now with Andy Furco and his group and the outreach and engagement, as well as our extension partners, to try to look at different strategies. Thank you for the question.
Regent Swigum, does that do it, or any follow-up?
It does, Mr. Chairman. Let me just quickly, and not necessarily a response, but Mary, I'm glad you're attentive to it. I don't want to be too challenging, but enrollment, as you know, is key. And as much as we can do with global partnerships and international recruitment, that's all good. That's all important. But we got to make the sale at home, and you know that. And we got to have kids from Ada. We got to have kids from Foston. We got to have kids from Thief River Falls. There's got to be a regional affinity, not a lost affinity. And we'll try to work with you and help you and support you in that effort, Mary, to help that regional affinity be there.
Thank you very much, Regent Swigum.
All right, thank you.
We have Vice Chancellor Hoffman now on the line.
Oh, great. And I think, if Vice Chancellor Hoffman, if we can go over to you now.
Thank you, Chair Powell. And I think I'm responding to questions perhaps from both Regent Swigum and Regent McMillan. The question regarding the faculty and the proportion of faculty who are tenure track, and you used the term faculty. And for our campus, we have three term faculty, but a larger proportion of our non-tenure track faculty are professional and administrative faculty who are full-time. A little bit of quick context on this. So 3 years ago when I arrived, worked closely with Vice Provost Ropers on developing a faculty personnel plan for our campus. This connects both to our HLC requirements, it also connects to the University of Minnesota policy requirements, and also to an analysis that we did with our faculty in terms of what is an appropriate balance. What we laid out there is that at least 50% of our faculty should be tenured or tenure track, that 2/3 of our courses should be taught by full-time faculty, and that 1/3 of those of our courses should be taught by tenured or tenure track faculty. And we've maintained some pretty aggressive moves over the past 2 years to get in compliance with those ratios. That's the good news. The challenging news for us, I think, is that our faculty numbers are down about 8% over that time period. One of the elements that really comes into play, given the fact that our faculty carry very heavy teaching loads, the heaviest in the system, is the place where the pinch occurs is in the service activities. Those service time, the time that faculty spend outside of class, not necessarily directly in scholarship activities, sometimes it's related to that, but working directly with our students. And this is where I would bring in the question by Regent Swigum and the local game. It's a relationship game in the region, and our faculty have to have time and space to be engaging in the communities surrounding our campus in order for us to win our home district. As you've mentioned. And frankly, the pinch of the last couple of years, it's a very hardworking faculty. I wouldn't exchange them for any group in the system, but it is difficult to ask much more of them at this point. We do have a couple plans in place where we're working on making some adjustments. You know, adding one faculty adds this much to that service capacity. Making a few other adjustments with what we're doing internally can perhaps add a little bit more. And so I think good things are going to be happening in that realm in the coming years.
Very good. I'm glad we were able to get you into the conversation, Vice Chancellor Hoffman. I appreciate your comments. Regent McMillan, you raised this issue. Does that address it?
I think we got to everything. I had thrown a bunch out there. I'm good for now. Let's keep going with other regents. Thank you, Vice Chancellor Hoffman.
All right. Regent Rocha.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And thank you, Chancellor Holzklaus. This is very comprehensive. This is a great report. First, on your horse program and the jump in numbers, news travels quickly. I've been hearing of a lot of people that are, you know, young folks that are going to the program that are involved in you know, horse raising, horse showing in the area. So congratulations on that. But I think that's actually a really good example of what I want to lead into, which follows very much from what Regents McMillan and Spigum just talked about. The horse program, I think, is really sort of isolated. It's insulated, I should say, from the issue of tuition because it's unique. There aren't a lot of these programs across the country, and obviously the I think the resource considerations for people pursuing that career are usually not as big as they might be for the general population, and so I think that's something where good marketing, which as you pointed out was I think a big part of why you had that significant improvement, we should continue and continue to build that program. But it's really different for the rest of the campus. And you know, by way of a little background, just, you know, about 30 years ago, a little less than 30 years ago, Chancellor Crookston rather was a 2-year vocational agricultural school. I served on this board with Stan Sahlstrom, Regent Sahlstrom, who had been the first chancellor of that program. I've had horses trained by Lyle Wick, was one of the first leaders of your equestrian program. And in the restructuring of the university in 91, when this board took the long view, it was determined that the university would not be part of 2-year VOAG or vocational training. The Waseca campus was closed and Crookston was then converted into a 4-year school. And obviously there's a whole lot that has to happen with that. And I think the school has done a good job of navigating what is a challenging environment. Why it's especially challenging for Crookston? Well, it's because Crookston offers a product that has had static demand at best. We've seen more and more as populations become more urban and suburban, people are looking for the large research university experience. And that's why places like the Twin Cities campus have had such huge demand. But other smaller programs, private liberal arts programs have struggled because fewer people are wanting to go away from home into a smaller environment when they're used to living in a more populated environment. So for me, the challenge at Crookston is really simple. And this even goes to the regional demand. We can't be higher in tuition. We simply can't be higher in tuition than North Dakota. All the surrounding states are taking Minnesota students at their in-state rates or very close to their in-state rates. And bottom line is, if we don't come in with the prestige of a Princeton or a Stanford, this is a utility driven educational process. And so people will absolutely look at the difference in the tuition between what they'll be paying for Crookston versus what they'll pay just to go across the border into North Dakota with schools that, you know, in the area, certainly with marketing capacity, have a much higher profile and let alone the fact that they've got billboards, you know, all throughout the third district as well as the rest of the state. So, you know, from that standpoint, I just want to say, we can talk about this a long, long time, and you are doing an amazing job with the resources that you have. But when students, you know, and obviously in the electronic age, students can look at hundreds of schools very quickly with the click of a mouse. So they know the schools are out there, and when they look at that price line and they say, "Jeepers, you know, it's a couple thousand bucks a year to go over to Crookston, or I can go to the larger, more comprehensive institution just across the border and save a couple grand at the same time," that part's not rocket science in my view. So I think that if the university is really going to be successful in developing our system campuses, the Twin Cities is the only one that benefits from the perception of the large comprehensive research university. Duluth is a little bit in between, but the bottom line is all 4 of our system campuses outside the Twin Cities are regional campuses, and in which case there's a huge sensitivity to it, to tuition. So if we're going to be committed to the growth in those regions, and I think it's actually I think making the investment to bring tuition in line is actually going to pay dividends, because with enrollment going up, the marginal cost of those students will be less than that tuition that's drawn from them. And eventually you can get to the size that you've got the resources from the students to maintain a full offering of experiences for your students. And we end up in the same place financially. We've got to take a little bit of risk to get there, but you know, I would strongly favor the university system sending more resources to the system campuses so we can be competitive. And, you know, again, look across, you know, you look at what's happening in those schools. There's a reason they're priced where they are, because they're attracting our students. And I don't see Duluth in competition with Crookston, in competition with Morris and Rochester. They're really regional competitions. We're losing that because we're just simply charging $2 more for a bushel of apples than our neighbors in North Dakota are. So thank you, Mr. Chair. I feel strongly about this, and I hope at some point we can do some real analysis to get us into a place where we're not just having the same conversation every 5 or 10 years about something novel to try to get people's attention when ultimately they're going to make the decision based on those financial considerations. Thank you.
Thank you. Regent Rocha for the comment and that view. And Chancellor, can you give us your thoughts and reactions on, you know, the point about price sensitivity and elasticity and, you know, that whole area of strategic pricing, and what have you learned?
Thank you very much, Regent Rocha, for that question, and Regent Powell. And I'm also going to let Vice Chancellor Hoffman speak about this, because I know that he's done a lot of work on the price sensitivity. One of the areas, though, I would really like to address is, first of all, let's talk about Minnesota students. When we look at Minnesota students and those that are Pell eligible, particularly, and others, that then with the assistance that they receive from the state of Minnesota, we come in a very strong price competitive area. When we look at price sensitivity with our North Dakota and South Dakota partners, I'll let, as I said, Regent Vice Chancellor Hoffman, I just gave him a promotion, I believe, as a Regent Hoffman, Vice Chancellor Hoffman, address that a little bit more about the impact on that. We have done some price sensitivity analysis and we need to do more, but, and again, I'll let him speak specifically about what we have learned with that. And in the meantime, I was going to say, Regent Rocha, we are in really strong need of having some good Morgan horses up in our area. So I know you may have some connections in that area. So, and Vice Chancellor Hoffman, if you want to speak a little bit more about some of the price sensitivities. So as an economist, I should be better versed on this, but this is something that I've asked Vice Chancellor Hoffman to look into.
All right, Vice Chancellor.
Yes, thank you, Regent Powell and Regent Rocha and Chancellor Holzclaws for the referral here. Regent Rocha, there is a degree to which I very much agree with you, and that is the concern about cost. It is deeply impactful for our students at the University of Minnesota Crookston, and it is an important part of their decision-making piece. I also note that while our data show that we lose significantly more students to the University of Minnesota Twin Cities campus and to Duluth, both campuses that are more expensive, I also recognize there may be some students who fail to apply to Crookston simply because they look at the sticker price and they move on to the next institution. I do believe that part of that issue then is an issue of marketing and messaging, because the net cost for the University of Minnesota Crookston is very competitive in the regional marketplace. And when we look at the data about the loans, the average loans that our students carry once they graduate from the University of Minnesota Crookston, that is a place, again, where we're competitive. When we look at some of the recent analyses of how long does it take for our graduates to pay for their investments, 3.0 years. That is second within the University of Minnesota system, eighth in the state of Minnesota in terms of the shortest amount of time it takes to pay off the investment in your college degree with the additional earnings that you make once you graduate. And whereas we may not carry the panache of the Twin Cities campus, we are a University of Minnesota campus, and we're very proud of the quality of education and our affiliation with the strength of that Block M. I'll also note that for our campus in particular, because we have such a high proportion, more than twice that of the system as a whole, of students who are Pell recipients and also many of those, you know, state grant recipients. If we were to lower our tuition price, we lower the amount of revenue that we bring in from the federal government and the state government because of where those, some of those places, some of those aid places can stop. We can go a little bit further in, but I know we had a conversation about this in a prior meeting with the Regents about the impact of price sensitivity at Crookston, Morris, Duluth in particular as campuses. The number of students, additional students that we would have to bring in to offset the loss in revenue is quite large and at this point well beyond our most aggressive projections about where we can grow in the next couple of years. And so I think my personal feeling is that investing in the retention efforts, ensuring that side of the quality, investing in the marketing efforts are the places where we can really advance the work of our campus and of the system as a whole, respectfully.
All right. Well, thank you. Regent Rocha, follow on.
Thank you. I appreciate that, but the bottom line is the Twin Cities is not the competitor. I mean, the students that want to go to the Twin Cities are going to go to the Twin Cities. And if they don't go to the Twin Cities, they're probably going to go to another large comprehensive research university. As we know, 30% leave the state. And part of that is an admissions issue if they're not admitted. And then you look at, you know, with our system campuses, there's a good number of students, as we can see from the transfer rate after the first year. If they're not getting into the program they want in the Twin Cities, they'll go to Crookston or UMD. And they'll apply to transfer after their first year and they get admitted with fairly high level of certainty. Bottom line is the numbers don't lie. And there's a challenge numbers wise at Crookston. Again, you know, you're not losing anybody to the Twin Cities horse program because there isn't one. And so that's why I think that is a program that can continue to build and be strong. But for the other things that are being offered, they're being offered at NDSU. They're being offered at the Twin Cities, they're River Falls, you know, they're all these other schools. You just, you know, if you add that marginal cost difference, I just think that's a real challenge. And so you say you would take a lot of students to make up the difference. My sense is from conversations that I'm hearing about long-term effect for some of the campuses around the state, I think that you do need a large number of students to be cost effective as a residential campus. And so That's why I think it's a very, very important concept that we just simply, when the demand is already higher, when the demand for the apples at NDSU with a larger, more comprehensive experience is already greater than it is for what we're offering at what I consider and agree, I think it's an amazing campus. I think it's a gem and I have very strong support for Crookston, but to have a lower demand and a higher price is just, you know, from an economic standpoint is not a recipe for long-term success. I do think you need to get those numbers up. And that's I think, a real key element to doing it. Thanks, Mr. Chair. I don't mean to be, you know, too direct, but we don't get these conversations very often. So
Very good. All right, thank you. We'll move on now. I see one more hand raised. Regent Mayron.
Thank you, Chair Powell. I am focusing on the materials that were provided to us in connection with today's presentation. And I was looking at the section on what strategies will be employed to manage administrative costs. Specifically, the analysis that was provided to us at page 47 of our materials. And what I noted, and you've set this off in a wonderful fashion, but you've really impressed on us how Crookston is a very lean institution in terms of the percentage of administrative employees per student and also the number of administrators that you have and what you've done to consolidate various positions. And I applaud you on what you've done in terms of how lean, as you say you are. My question is, though, can you talk to us about what the impact of being so lean is on your operations and whether this is the way you want to proceed or whether you would like to see the numbers increase in terms of percentage of employees per student or administrators as well? I'd love to hear your comments on that. What impact is this leanness had on you and what would you like to see the direction that you go in the future?
Thank you. Thank you, Regent Mayron. Chancellor Holtz-Klaus.
Thank you very much for your question, Regent Mayron. And as we look going forward, like many of our campuses, we had a lot of people also who took the Rio. And so what we are doing right now is very strategically making decisions about what would be good hire backs when we're able to fill those positions. Certainly our emergency positions have been filled. We had a nurse who retired. We had some of our security people who retired. And so those have been filled with exceptions because of the importance there. But what we're doing right now is evaluating and looking in and what are our actual needs. Again, trying to make sure that we're right-sized, but it certainly has had an impact when we are sometimes just one person deep on several key functions that need to be addressed. And so again, we're looking at bringing individuals on when we are able to, that are strategically going to meet those needs. So we're prioritizing some of our priorities are, for instance, our business office right now, we're down to 3 individuals. And so that's going to have an effect, could potentially have an effect downline on other issues. And so we're trying to determine what we can do ourselves. We're also using, for instance, the Talent Share Program, which is a program that's available from the Twin Cities. And in our business office, we've used their assistance and help to help us process things. We're also working and looking, in addition to more sense of admissions, our registrar, we're sharing positions when we can. And so we're sharing a registrar position right now with the University of Minnesota Morris. So going forward, being very strategic and yet recognizing that there are many times when we need additional assistance. And that's also a strength of the system. We've also unfortunately had a key person in our human resources who, actually 2 people in our human resources, and that was our entire department, left us. And so we've been fortunate to be able to utilize the services of the Twin Cities to help us through these rough things. So first of all, I'd like to give a shout out for all the assistance that we have received, both from our other campuses and the Twin Cities and the system to help us with that. But going forward, we need to be realistic. As Vice Chancellor Hoffman said, our teaching load is incredibly high. We're being very strategic about looking at hiring back faculty when it makes sense. And there are just a number of areas where right now we are beginning to have very serious conversations about what do we need, where can we get that assistance if it's available, as I said, for us, or if we need to hire. We're also, and I think you will hear this from many people, we're also in a very competitive job situation now, which to me is kind of surprising coming out of the pandemic. But it's very difficult sometimes to find talent. And we're very close to Grand Forks. And so we also compete with the University of North Dakota, particularly for individuals. So what we try to do when we do have openings is to move as quickly as possible so we don't lose good candidates. Our faculty and our staff have heard both Vice Chancellor Hoffman and I say, please move as fast as you can. Because every time that we delay by not making hiring decisions quickly, we potentially lose individuals there. So going forward, it's a challenge, and it's a challenge that we're trying to mitigate that as well as we can with different strategies, as well as really prioritize, which is what we're doing now. There have been times when we've been stretched. I will be very honest with you. Thank you very much for your question.
All right, thank you. All right. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for a very good discussion. And Chancellor, thank you so much for your work. We so appreciate your leadership and the leadership of your team. And you're really I think attacking the challenges in a very, very, as you said, it's a very focused way. And we're very highly supportive, as you can hear from the engagement and the questions. So thank you very much. We're going to take a break now. I know that the committees are next up, but we're also in new business. President Gable would like to give us an update on some of the health and safety points that she mentioned earlier in the meeting. And so we have a little more business in front of us. Let's take a break. It's 10:05 now. Let's return and be ready to go at 10:15. and we'll go through our concluding items. So we'll all be back at 10:15.
Mr. Chair, we're live. You can proceed.
All right. Welcome back to one and all. I'm just trying to get my Zoom page in the right place. And which it's not for some reason. Bear with me. Anyway, I can hear you, so we'll just go with that. So we are on the committee business. A reminder that if there were multiple items voted on in the committee, we will take all the unanimous recommendations of the committee as one motion. So that is, all items that were recommended unanimously will be taken together in one vote, unless any member of the board would like to separate any of those items from the motion, following our normal practice for consent. So let's begin with a report of the Audit and Compliance Committee. And Regent Rocha, please share your report with us.
Mr. Chair, I'm having a couple technical difficulties. Could I have a moment? And if you could move
sure.
on.
Sure. Yeah, me too.
Thank you. It's going to take me a minute. You might move to another committee report if you would.
All right. I will do that. Let's see here.
Chair Powell, I can do litigation review.
Please do, Regent McMillan.
All right. The Litigation Review Committee met yesterday. At this meeting, we adopted a resolution that authorized the closing of the meeting to discuss matters subject to attorney-client privilege. That concludes my report.
Thank you, Regent McMillan. And staying with you, Regent McMillan, let's move to the report of the Finance and Operations Committee. Back to you.
Very good. Thanks, Chair Powell. And this is the committee that normally has the long list of business. Yesterday was an exception. We talked a lot about things, but I only have a couple items for business. The report of the Finance and Ops Committee includes one item that was unanimously recommended by the committee for approval by the board. That item was the consent report, which includes the Central Reserve's general contingency, the purchase of goods and services, $1 million and over, an amendment to the employment agreement of Joe Rossi, defensive coordinator on the Twin Cities campus, the resolution related to the issuance of debt, three real estate transactions, one schematic design, the extension of principles for allocating federal COVID-19 relief funds, and approval of underwriting investment banking services. There were no other items voted on by the committee this month, and I move approval of the committee report.
All right, thank you, Regent McMillan. Are there any regents with questions or comments on that consent report that comes from the Finance and Operations Committee? I don't see any hands raised, so seeing none, Mr. Steves, will you please call the roll?
On the Finance and Operations Committee report, Regent Davenport.
Yes.
Regent Davenport votes yes. Regent Farnsworth.
Yes.
Regent Farnsworth votes yes. Regent Hipsch.
Yes.
Regent Hipsch votes yes. Regent Johnson.
Yes.
Regent Johnson votes yes. Regent Kenyanya.
Yes.
Regent Kenyanya votes yes. Regent Mayron.
Yes.
Regent Mayron votes yes. Regent McMillan.
Yes.
Regent McMillan votes yes. Regent Rocha.
Yes.
Regent Rocha votes yes. Regent Swigum.
Yes.
Regent Swigum votes yes. Regent Verhalen.
Yes.
Regent Verhalen votes yes. Chair Powell.
Yes.
Chair Powell votes yes. Mr. Chair, there are 11 in favor and 0 opposed.
All right. Thank you. That motion is approved. Regent McMillan, any other or additional committee business?
No additional committee business, Chair Powell. That concludes my report.
All right. Thank you. We'll move on to the Mission Fulfillment Committee. Regent Davenport, your report.
Thank you, Chair Powell. The Mission Fulfillment Committee report includes two items that were unanimously recommended by the committee for approval by the board. These items include, first, the promotion, tenure, and annual continuous appointment recommendations, and second, the consent report, which includes approval of academic program changes and conferral of tenure for outside faculty hires. I move approval of the committee report.
All right. Before I call for vote, any regent like to separate one of these items? All right. I see no hands raised. Any questions? All right. Looks like we have no questions or comments here. So, Mr. Steves, if you could call the roll for on the mission fulfillment report.
On the mission fulfillment report, Regent Davenport.
Yes.
Regent Davenport votes yes. Regent Farnsworth.
Yes.
Regent Farnsworth votes yes. Regent Hipsch.
Yes.
Regent Hipsch votes yes. Regent Johnson.
Yes.
Regent Johnson votes yes. Regent Kenyanya.
Yes.
Regent Kenyanya votes yes. Regent Mayron.
Yes.
Regent Mayron votes yes. Regent McMillan.
Yes.
Regent McMillan votes yes. Regent Rocha.
Yes.
Regent Rocha votes yes. Regent Swigum.
Yes.
Regent Swigum votes yes. Regent Verhaelen.
Yes.
Regent Verhaelen votes yes. Chair Powell.
Yes.
Chair Powell votes yes. Mr. Chair, there are 11 in favor and zero opposed.
All right, that motion is approved. Regent Davenport, any additional committee business?
Thank you, Chair Powell. That concludes my report.
All right, thank you. And Regent Rocha, back to you for the audit committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm going to sit very still in hopes that everything keeps working. the Audit and Compliance Committee did not consider any action items this month. We had discussion on three topics. First, Controller Sue Paulson provided a review of the audit and not audit services provided to the university by external audit firms during this fiscal year, including the work performed by Deloitte, who serves as our external auditor. We also received an update on the access management audit that was completed last year, and we were pleased to learn that the progress made on addressing these critical recommendations is proceeding. Finally, we received a comprehensive overview of the university's conflict of interest programs and the important differentiation of individual versus institutional conflicts of interest. Thank you, Chair Powell. That concludes my report.
Thank you, Regent Rocha, for that report. Okay, that brings us to old business now. Any old business to come before the board? I don't see any hands up. New business to come before the board? President Gable, I believe you want to raise some new business.
You're muted.
I believe you're muted.
Honestly, looping back to my remarks this morning about the university's decision regarding the mask mandate, with appreciation for Chair Powell's expeditious management of today's full board meeting, he has moved faster than we were able to. So I don't have the full report for the board or for the community who may be watching right now, but I will share with you and we'll follow up with a memo that, as you know, the governor announced the end of the statewide mask mandate, but it has not yet taken effect. We're expecting the actual decision to come later today. As has been the case throughout the pandemic, when decisions like this are made, they are the vast majority of the time accompanied by guidance from the Minnesota Department of Health. As we have done as the Emergency Management Committee, both in the decisions that are through our delegated authority or in the decisions that we've brought before the board for approval, we have tried to align and have, for all intents and purposes, aligned with that guidance throughout this process. And so we want to wait for the details of that guidance before we announce our final decision about the effect of the mask mandate for the university campus community. And so as soon as that guidance is out, we will be releasing instructions to our campus community and we'll make the board aware of those instructions at that time.
Is that all, President Campbell?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I don't see any other hands raised so for new business. So now, look, everyone, sadly, I'm gonna have to finish, we're gonna have to conclude this meeting on a very, very sad note. Within the last few minutes, we have learned that Regent Herr's family has released the news that Regent Herr passed away last night. And so that is public information now. I know that we're all devastated by this news. She was a great colleague and a strong voice on our board for diversity and inclusion statewide. And we're going to miss her. And so this is just terrible, terrible news. There will be more news coming. But I wanted you all to know that the family has publicly released that information, and we'll get you more as we know. And I regret that we have to end on such devastating news, but this is the way it is. Joan, I don't know if you want to add any comments.
Yes, thank you, Ken. So just because we are together and have the opportunity to speak on behalf of the university community, I want to make sure we do so in saying how heartbroken we all are to learn of Eileen's passing. For many of us on the university campus, absolutely myself included, she was the warmest advocate and friend, and also the fiercest, and found that intersection of warmth and passion in such a uniquely important and meaningful way. Her service to the university was remarkable. Her service to the entire state of Minnesota, and in particular Minnesota's Hmong and Asian American Pacific Islander communities, is so well known and will be a tremendous loss. We're so proud to count her as an alum and an advocate and a friend, and we will miss her terribly.
Trying to unmute here. Regents, I know there's really nothing else that we can say today. We will keep you informed as we get additional news. And of course, there are going to be, you know, many, many avenues to communicate and to pay our respects. And but with, you know, out of respect for the family now, and they're dealing with this, I think we'll just acknowledge this sad news and we'll move on and adjourn the meeting now. So without any new business, and we are now adjourned. Thank you.